What's going on, guys? My name is Matt, and I've talked extensively about upgrading pre-builds on this channel. With that being said, most of the focus has been on full-size machines, and I've neglected to make many videos about slim desktop PCs. In today's video, I'm going to take this modest office computer, upgrade a few of its specs, and throw in a dedicated graphics card. Then I'm going to show you how this guy performs in a number of different games like Fortnite and the new COD Warzone. Thanks to Squarespace for sponsoring this video. From websites and online stores to marketing tools and analytics, Squarespace is the all-in-one platform to build a beautiful online presence and run your business. Now, I'd usually never recommend anyone buy one of these slimline PCs unless they get it for an insane deal, but many people have systems like this and want to know if they can upgrade them for gaming. The big factor that led to me making this video is the fact that low-profile GTX 1650s are now available, and tons of you guys asked me to test one in an old Dell. This is the GTX 1650 low-profile from Zotac, and it's a pretty powerful card for how small it is. Opening up the box, we find a driver disk, which don't use, just get the latest drivers from Nvidia's website. Then we have the card itself in a low-profile bracket. Switching between the full-size and this half-size bracket allows this card to work in both full-sized and slim desktops. It comes with the full size bracket installed by default, and switching them out is super simple. You just unscrew two screws, then unscrew these two standoffs on the DVI port. This frees the bracket, and the new one can be put into place and secured with the two standoffs and two screws. The GTX 1650 isn't a very popular card, but it's the most powerful GPU that runs off of only internal PCIe power, unlike, for example, the RX 570, which requires an 8-pin connector. This is very important because most pre-builds, especially these slimline ones, do not have PCIe power connectors. This Zotac model has a dual fan design with a basic aluminum heatsink. Temps and noise were acceptable, but I'll get into more specifics about those later in the video. With the bracket changed out, the 1650 is now ready to be installed, but first let's take a look at the PC this is going into and talk about what I'm upgrading within it. This is a Dell Optiplex 790, which released all the way back in 2011. These could be seen in office and schools for a pretty large period of time, and at one point they were decently expensive. But fast forward today, and you can now pick one of these up for super cheap. Opening up the side panel, you can see it's a pretty dense layout. To make sure I was going to get the most performance out of the 1650, I wanted to upgrade the CPU and RAM. To get at these parts, we first need to unclip the hard drive bay and pull it out. Next, I unclipped all 8 RAM clips and pulled out all 4 sticks of RAM. These were 4 2GB sticks for a total of 8GB, which for modern gaming is decent, but not ideal. Next, I unplugged the CPU fan connector and pushed some of the cables out of the way. This gave me room to unscrew the 4 heatsink screws. I could then lift the heatsink away and was greeted by the CPU socket. The CPU cooler is pretty neat. It uses copper heat pipes and aluminum fins in this flat orientation, and uses a blower style fan, which actually keeps the system relatively cool and quiet. Turning my attention back to the CPU socket, I went ahead and cleaned off the old thermal paste, opened up the socket, and removed the old CPU. The CPU that was in there was the Intel Core i5-2400S. This is decent for gaming, but I wanted to replace it with my favorite CPU for upgrading these old Dells, which is the Intel Xeon E3-1230. This guy is essentially a Core i7-2600 without the integrated graphics and with a significant price cut. I got this one for around $35, but they should be pretty easy to find for around $40, and I'll leave a link to some in the description. Selling the old i5 to offset the cost for the CPU would end up making this upgrade really only cost around $20, which is well worth it for the performance increase. With the socket open, I just put the new CPU into place and closed it up. I then applied an adequate amount of thermal paste and reinstalled the cooler. For RAM, I'm upgrading from 4 2GB sticks to 4 4GB sticks. Going to 16GB is very helpful, especially in modern games. Opening the slots back up, I just lined up and clipped each RAM stick into place one at a time until all 4 were installed. With this done, I could plug the hard drive back in and reinstall the hard drive caddy. Finally, we are now ready to install the graphics card. Doing this is actually very simple. I first just opened up the PCIe retention clip, got my card out, and pushed the cables aside while I lowered it into place. Once I was sure this was lined up, I just pressed it in and reclosed the PCIe retention clip. All that was left to do was put the side panel back on and test some games. But before we get into benchmarks, I want to take a minute to talk about today's sponsor, Squarespace. I've been a user of Squarespace long before they were a channel sponsor. A while back when I had a business making and selling custom 3D printed phone cases, I used Squarespace because they did and still do have, in my opinion, the best e-commerce system available. Squarespace is an all-in-one platform that handles all the confusing aspects of creating a website beyond just design, with stuff like SEO tools and a really robust set of analytics. If you're doing business online, you need a website, and Squarespace offers the best solutions available. I recently made a new website for myself that links all my different online presences into one central location. If you want to build a beautiful website and support the channel, then head on over to squarespace.com for a free trial. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/techbymatt to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. Thanks again to Squarespace for sponsoring this video, and now let's get into the benchmarks. I tested a ton of different games with this system to give you a good idea of how it performs. I used MSI Afterburner to track both the usage and temps of each component during the benchmarks. In terms of temps, the GPU sat around 70 to 74 degrees when under a gaming load, and the CPU sat around 65 to 70 degrees. Both of these are pretty acceptable, and while the system was noisy, it wasn't at all what I would consider obnoxious. If you game with headphones like I do, then the noise will be no problem at all, and under idle, doing basic tasks like watching videos, the system is very quiet. Let's start things off with COD Warzone, a very new and popular title. In this game, at 1080p low settings, the system stayed in the upper 60s FPS-wise the majority of my time playing. This honestly was both a smooth and enjoyable experience. Next up is Doom Eternal. I used the high preset at 1080p to test the game and found the FPS hovered between 50 and 60. This was a pretty smooth experience and I didn't see any noticeable lag spikes. Doom Eternal is a very modern game, and dropping the settings would likely net you a 60 FPS average. Next up is Rainbow Six Siege at 1080p high settings. I used the built-in benchmark to test the system. There was an overall average of 134 FPS. This is good to see because you really want high frame rates in a game like Rainbow Six. Now let's move on to CSGO. I played this game at 1080p pro settings. The FPS stayed around the mid to upper 100s most of the time. This was a smooth experience, and while higher FPS would have been ideal, the reality is that this was a playable experience. Rust, I tested at 1080p with the settings shown on screen. The FPS stayed between 50 and 60 the vast majority of the time. I'm not sure if these are good settings for us. Let me know what you play with in the comment section below. Next up is PUBG at 1080p medium settings. In this game, the system stayed around the 70 FPS mark, which was a pretty good experience, and this was through various scenarios, including driving. Finally, let's talk about Fortnite. At 1080p pro settings, the system saw a lot of fluctuations in frame rates, but the FPS stayed around the 130 mark the majority of the time, which was a very smooth experience. Overall, this little Dell with the E3 Xeon, 16 gigs of RAM, and low profile 1650 play pretty much anything you can throw at it. Again, I wouldn't recommend going out and buying one of these slim PCs, but if you already have one, upgrading it may be a good idea. With this being said, I still would recommend starting from scratch or starting with a full-size Dell Optiplex. So yeah guys, I think this wraps this video up. Thanks again to Squarespace for sponsoring this video. Make sure to check out the link in the description if you're interested in building a beautiful website. If you guys enjoyed this video, make sure to give it a thumbs up and consider subscribing. And as always, this is Matt from Tech by Matt, signing out.